Welcome to the Virginia Hospital and Healthcare Association's Patients Come First podcast series. Podcast episodes are available on VHHA.com and on popular podcast hosting apps, including Apple Podcasts, Amazon, Spotify, and many others. We're a member of the Public Health Podcast Network, the Virginia Audio Collective, and the World Podcast Network. Podcast episodes also air each Sunday at noon on 100.5 FM, 92.7 FM, and 820 AM across Central Virginia, 1650 AM in Hampton Roads, 105.1 FM and 1050 AM in Lynchburg, and Wednesdays at 1 PM on 93.9 FM in Richmond. Please send questions, comments, feedback, or guest suggestions to pcfpodcast@vhha.com. Again, that's pcfpodcast@vhha.com. And today we're pleased to be joined by Sue Henneberry, a Richmond area woman who volunteers at Sheltering Arms Institute, a provider she previously encountered as a rehabilitation patient following a limb amputation. During our conversation, we're going to learn more about Sue, the medical condition that led to her amputation, her impressive athletic achievements since then, and much more. So with that, welcome to the show. Sue, thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Well, it's our pleasure, and we really appreciate the opportunity to speak with you today. We like to start these conversations by learning more about our guests. What we know is that you are a New Jersey native, as am I, go Jersey, and a lifelong active person. In recent years, you've become active as a volunteer with Sheltering Arms and an athlete with Sportable Richmond, an organization that provides competitive sports programs to people with physical disabilities. Those affiliations follow a leg amputation a few years ago after a prolonged medical journey. We're going to discuss your medical experiences a bit later in the podcast, but first, if you would, get us rolling by telling us a few things about your unique personal story.
Probably one of the unique things about being an amputee I noticed is mine was due to an infection, yes, but it's COVID, and COVID is so new to everybody. COVID triggered what we call long COVID, and you can hear my voice. I still suffer from a lot of different side effects, and one was it triggered a wound on my foot that I didn't know about. And for almost a year, I tried to fix it with doctors, with medicine and everything else, and then chose to be amputated. And that's a little different than anybody being in a traumatic event or a diabetic or something like that, that you hear more of loss of limb. So it's a little different than most.
Understood. Any other things about yourself, non-medical related, that people should know?
I don't know. I'm mother of four girls and a little dog. And truthfully, yeah, I've chose to do sports a lot in my life, and I'm conquering quite a bit of trying different things that I've never done before. From this summer or July, I rode across Iowa on a bike upright, 455 miles in 7 days. It was kind of crazy, but very rewarding emotionally and physically. So I like to try different things now. It opened up a world for me to be able to say, yes, try things instead of just going, I'm not sure. I don't know if I want to do that. Yeah, try it. What do you have to lose?
Listen, that's great. We all only have one trip around the sun, so you better enjoy it.
Yep.
So yes. You alluded to this, and I want to explore this a little bit more. You talked about your limb amputation a few years ago. You had your left foot and a portion of your lower left leg removed, as I understand it, following a sustained infection that you mentioned that would not properly heal. This infection manifested following a bout you had with COVID-19 and I think also pneumonia in 2021. And then, as you said, ultimately you made the choice to amputate. I wonder if you can tell us more about those circumstances and both the emotional and mental process you went through prior to making such a significant decision.
Super hard. And I'm learning more now at my second year on how everybody processes all of it, whether it's grief or the pain, physical pain. Some people would grieve right away, and some people like me are now kind of going, you know, the emotional journey and the physical journey are very hard and unique to everyone. For me, it triggered when I got COVID pneumonia, never been so scared, not being able to breathe, living alone. I had only recently separated from my husband, and my children were grown, but to live alone, I didn't even have an animal at the time. And you're so scared, you can't breathe. You're hearing all the horror stories of people dying, and your daughter's a nurse saying, you know, we see a lot, don't come here unless you have to. And it was the scariest few months before, you know, the pneumonia started to settle in and the medication would work. But for months, I just couldn't get out of it. I still couldn't smell. I still couldn't taste. Every morning waking with a massive headache, kind of like when you're a kid and you're drunken stupor, you had too many, you wake up with that hangover headache where your head's going to pop off. I had that almost every day, and still 3 years later. things that you just think would go away, but nobody knows enough about COVID, and we still don't. There's only one doctor right now that's at VCU that I've been dealing with that it still has patients that are, you know, but yet there's 2 million around the world that are suffering long COVID. So it's tough. You have to be your own advocate, and that's kind of who I've been. And if you fast forward years ago when I lived in Jersey, the reason we moved here in 2011 was I had been on crutches for 8 or 9 years at the time already, suffering what they call RSD at the time and now called CRIPS or complex regional pain syndrome. We couldn't get a handle on it. It was from knee down, and finally found a doctor in Baltimore to remove my sympathetic nerves, hence made that leg from knee down on the left side numb. And probably when you fast then forward 10 years later, when the COVID pneumonia and your body was achy, I didn't know that achy on the bottom of my foot was a wound. I just thought it was achy, you know, mm-hmm. or I had a callus on my foot. It wasn't until I had really bad GI issues with COVID too. So the middle of the summer of 21, I was battling H. pylori and on a lot of antibiotics for that and an ulcer. So that when September came around, when I finally did go to a podiatrist, because that wasn't getting any better, he says, that's not a callus or achy feet. That's a wound. I'm like, what's a wound, you know? Mm-hmm. And it led to many. I mean, for the next, like I said, months, we did the wound care with different dressings every week or so. And then we went to the food and we went to, I had 2 different surgeries right away to offset pressure. One in the hospital, one outpatient, because again, I didn't feel it. And I'm like, do it here. I don't want to get knocked out. And I broke a bone on my big toe to try and offset the, because it was pretty much right under that big bone. And anyway, too many of them. And went to he said, let's go to a vascular surgeon and see what he said. And I didn't even know what that meant. And then I went, oh, that's what that means. And he goes, well, yeah, it's looking like the infection's getting worse. Let's try one more thing, because he swore. He said, when I cut S off, I don't know if I can swear here.
No, this is a family program.
Right. So when I cut stuff off, I can't put it back on. And I liked how frank he was. So I went, okay. Went back to the podiatrist. We tried one more thing. And then I had a wound on the side of my foot, right by the side of your big toe. If you're feeling it on the outside edge. And I went, how is that possible from just weight and pressure? You know, mm-hmm. I said, I'm done. I had like 5 different holes at the bottom of my foot. It was so super red. If anybody follows me, it's probably on Facebook somewhere. I've seen pictures, because I'm pretty open about that. It's tough to look at. And I actually keep that on my phone just to remind me that I did do the right thing. And went back to him and he said, you ready? And I said, I think so. And he said, I'm off next week, but how about Tuesday the following? I'm like, oh. So I had a week to prepare, and that was actually pretty good, because I could go visit 2 prosthetists and hear what they had to say. Got information from a wonderful woman that was still a mentor of mine. It's been 15 plus years as an above amputee. And, you know, I immediately started that ripple. Who can I reach out to? Well, who better than somebody that's also going through what we go through, mm-hmm. or that I'm going to end up going through. And it was so scary. Then go to the hospital. My daughter had taken me, and my ex-husband said, can I come be with Megan? I said, absolutely. We're cordial. And, you know, and then Megan, my daughter, says, Dad wants to come in first. I'm like, okay, you know, 5 minutes before I'm getting wheeled down. And he was emotional and he was crying and he was telling me, your life is going to be so hard now. And I said, you're doing this now? And like, I'm getting all weepy. And I, you know, it was just nice for him to be. And then he was always very supportive still afterwards, as, you know, we're not together, but it's still nice to have people that are, you know, had knew me, how much time we had gone through, 10 plus years in Jersey of me fighting this foot for so long. And that was my comment. I had fought it for so long, now almost a year doing it again. I said, John, it's just time. I can't keep doing this. I'm just being so compromised, because the rest of my health was getting compromised. I was feeling weaker. I still wasn't eating well and losing weight. And we just knew it had to go. I mean, I did. So he was like, you sure? It was hard. It's still emotional.
Yeah.
And you look down and you go, huh.
Yeah, no, and I appreciate you sharing all that. It sounds like a process. And sometimes in life, we go through processes that take us on a roller coaster, whether emotional, yeah. mental, or what have you. So I appreciate you sharing that with us. You mentioned
it is all of that. Yeah.
yeah. You mentioned consulting with prosthetic specialists prior to your mm-hmm. procedure. after surgery, you went through rehabilitation at Sheltering Arms, which is a nationally recognized rehabilitation provider that offers inpatient and outpatient services. I wonder if you would, can you take us back to that time and tell us what both the recovery process was like for you, as well as getting fitted for and accustomed to a prosthetic?
Going to Sheltering Arms was game changer for me. They were lovely. 5 days after surgery, I went there, and I was there for about 2 weeks, I think. And you started the process from day one of wearing a shrinker and what the device, this plastic tube that was on your leg that looked like the thing that you put up the bank where you put your money in, the plastic tube you put on your arm, and all the reasons for these things, you know, to keep your hamstrings straight so you don't lose and have atrophy set in, and a shrinker for the pain and ice. And they taught you all that and how to get in and out of wheelchairs. But I was already very good at crutches, so we kind of used that more than the wheelchair. And how to get in and out of a shower, how to get in and out of the bathroom, how to brush your teeth. You know, they teach you everything at Sheltering Arms. They have a kitchen to teach you how to cook from a sit in a wheelchair, how to reach for cabinets. Oh, gosh, how to remember to lock your wheelchair and not get up. I mean, everything. They're so good about PT, OT. They have occupational therapy where, you know, learn to go to the store, learn to play golf again, whatever you want to do. Or whatever your lifestyle is, they're going to try and tweak it and help you and find a way to get you accustomed to you, which was great. And before I left, Sheltering Arm goes one further. To me, I always tell them it's like a piece of the pie. They ask you if you don't want one, you don't have to, but you have a mentor, somebody that comes that looks like you. If you're a stroke patient, they're in a wheelchair, just had a traumatic injury, now you're in a wheelchair for life. And, you know, that's scary. So was amputation. I had no idea really what, I mean, even going to the prosthetist in the very beginning to see, you know, feet around going, that's what that's going to look like. Your emotions are all over the place. And this beautiful woman, 78, as a double amputee, walking in from her Mercedes that she just drove herself to Sheltering Arms to come visit me. And we sat there in the lobby and had the nicest conversation. She had a smile on her face the whole time. It was so calming. And that was, to me, like the icing on the cake, like I said, or the piece of the pie that Sheltering Arm gives you. And she is somebody that I can, you know, and they say, if you need me afterwards, here's my number. And we've been in touch ever since. We're playing golf tomorrow. So it is that. It is that connection of making sure that once you're in a hospital setting, that the real world isn't as scary. You are going to be able to maneuver out there. There's people that are doing it that are older than you, that are double amputee, that whatever their situation, you can do this. You can see other people doing it. And Sheltering Arms really made it so it was accessible. They have a little car even. How do you get in and out of a car? Things that we all take for granted every day. There's a park right out front that has the cobblestones or up and down a little ramp, grass, regular sidewalks, brick sidewalks. All that kind of stuff is tough. So that when I came back to Sheltering Arms, 2 months later to get that prosthetic with the prosthetic leg, I'd gotten it on a Friday. Sunday, I checked into Sheltering Arms for a week as the first patient that they had for boot camp after the COVID shutdown. And they taught me how to put it on and off. And again, going outside, inside, they have the facility to be able to make it so much more comfortable. You don't trust this thing. I look at videos the way I walked way back then and seeing that I just didn't trust the leg. You step on it and you completely come right off of it. They really helped you master that of that trust and seeing what you're feeling so that you can actually make that fundamental of walking more natural.
I really appreciate you sharing that. The value of having a support system and a community, which you talked about, I think really can make all the difference. You recently celebrated your 2-year ampuversary, as they call it, and you've remained involved with Sheltering Arms as a volunteer. I wonder, what does that role entail and what inspires you to give back in that fashion?
As I had mentioned, my mentor, lovely woman that came in, I wanted to do that too. I wanted to be able to give back like she had. And so I went through Amputee Coalition. You have to get certified as a mentor. It's a week-long class, and then you get certified, and you get to actually go into hospitals or other environments. And Sheltering Arms requires that of us. So I go in as a mentor when they need. Again, they'll ask a patient who's an amputee, do you want somebody? And then they try and fit, whether you want a man, a woman, an athletic one, or somebody that just goes to church and back. So you know, they really try and match you with somebody that's going to be like you. And then I also go in now with my puppy. He's 2.5. He's a Cavapoo, and you do what's called the canine good citizen, and then his shots and whatnot, and he gets to go in and what they call give love. Sheltering Arms has little puppy magnets on the doorways of patients that would love to have a little, you know, petting and love and a visitor of that kind. And you can just see the brightness in people's faces when he comes, and they can have 5 minutes off of like their busy day of OTPT. It's lovely. It gives me, you know, as much as he's giving love to them, it just makes me feel good to know that I made their day.
That's awesome and really great to hear that you have remained connected and are paying it forward effectively.
That's exactly why, because they were so monumental to me. I love giving back.
That's great. From what I gather, you've been an active person for much of your life, and you alluded to this in our conversation earlier. You talked about some of the things that you have taken on since your amputation. I think you mentioned a pretty extensive bike race in Iowa. We are just coming off the summer of 2024, where the Paralympics was broadcast to much fanfare. And the Paralympics, for people who are not familiar, is an international competition for people with different abilities who can still pursue athletic achievement at a high level. You are also involved, from what I gather, in Sportable, which is a local adaptive sports organization. And I should mention that this podcast has previously featured Caitlin Berry, who's an occupational therapist at Sportable, so certainly familiar with some of the great work that they do. I wonder if you can tell us about your involvement with Sportable and your perspective on its importance, as well as the importance of being active as an outlet and a resource for people.
Huge. It's not even just for being a sports-minded person. It's for the emotional connection, for being around other people that need to laugh and have fun, that are disabled, instead of always having an avenue of sitting in their home and just staring at the couch. If they've got out and they get to meet people and you get to laugh and commiserate and try something you've never done before. I was January, so I wasn't even 3 months on my leg when Caitlin is the one that called me and told me my disability, I could play standing or sitting sports. And I said, what disability? So I was still on that mode of, this is just, you know, another surgery. And so she asked me, how about pickleball? And I was like, I've never played that. My kids played it in gym class. That was it. So I started a couple weeks later and playing pickleball. And I was so nervous to show up. I was, you know, you're fearful of what people will already look at you when you walk outside. You know, they stare right at your leg and immediately. But I walked in the door and I saw all these people in wheelchairs or not in wheelchairs, stroke patient only with one hand on a paddle. I looked around and everybody was so welcoming. And it was, and I got to laugh and as I miss a ball or something like that. So then fast forward, they said, how about running again? And okay, drive the Monument 10K with them and learned how to run and take the leg off and had support system of people running with me. I've done rock climbing and rowing with them. I've done so many things with Sportable. It's been amazing. I went to Pennsylvania to a rowing race with 150 disabled athletes from all over the country and the world. In a regatta, it was called, in the Schuylkill River, but they funded it and they helped bring up coaches in a boat and another athlete to row in a double with me. It was wonderful. And I will always give back to Sportable as well, because it's just been, I joke with them, a game changer for me, because it got me out of my emotional and physical shell. I'm gaining muscle and strength now. So you've taken yourself from an environment of PT and OT in a hospital setting. And now I get to step into a real world setting and using what I'm learning from pickleball and everything to give me strength to go up the stairs with a couple of grocery bags, because I'm gaining that muscle. But now I'm also gaining socialization. I'm comfortable going out and I'm even comfortable integrating myself. Like I said, I went to Iowa, but it was adaptive sports there that, you know, they ambassadored you in a way where they took on 20 people from around the country and they provided transportation and your luggage moving and that kind of stuff to ride across Iowa. So the opportunities, they've also helped me apply for a challenge athlete grant so I get a running blaze. So at the end of the year, my first year, I tried the half marathon here in Richmond. I was 4 days on this running blaze and it was emotional and it was wonderful. Physically, what a game changer for me. It was like I could conquer the biggest thing I've ever done. And now I'm trying to go even bigger. I'm going to try for the full this year. So, Well, fingers crossed.
That is, well, yes, absolutely. Best of luck. But that's fantastic to hear all the things that you're doing. And I mentioned New Jersey earlier. I also used to live in Philadelphia, so I am familiar with the regatta on the Schuylkill, and that is a spectacle every year. I want to land the plane with this. You talked about, and we've touched on this a bit, but the socialization aspect of it, as you said. So you're not just stuck inside, isolated, you know, staring at your couch, I think is the term that you used.
Yeah.
I hear in speaking with you such a positive and upbeat outlook. And we know that positive thinking can be powerful, but we also know that people have their ups and downs, their emotional and mental ups and downs. I wonder what observations or insights you can share about adopting that kind of positive mindset towards life, even in the face of challenges and adversity.
I might look on the surface that I do all these wonderful things, but there is days that I sit in that bed and don't want to get out myself. Look at the dog, and I have to take him out. So I have an obligation there. So it's little things that make you force you get out of bed, or, you know, reach out. It's that one step that you have to take. Take that one step to go out the door to walk the dog. Take that one step to pick up the phone and call somebody. There is, you know, somebody is out there for you. I've made such connections between sheltering arms and portables, and anywhere I go now, it's like this ripple effect. I'm meeting more and more people that I went seeing last year because I met people through when I went to the Gates Center, which was where I went to therapy after sheltering arms. A lot of amputees come through there, but a lot of heavy injury from hips and whatnot. But they have, you know, adaptive programs go through there as well. And I learned how to ski through therapeutic adventures. I went to Massanutten, and it was beautiful. Went to Charlottesville as well. You can just reach out and find something, even if it's not athletic. Sportable has a wellness. Go up to your computer and you get to meet people online, and you're going to do yoga or a mindful setting on the computer. There's dancing. There is just kayaking. Anybody can be in a kayak. And it's wonderful to have that freedom again from your disability just for a little while. And there's just so many people out there that help do whatever you want to do, even if it's just as simple to find somebody to take you to the grocery store.
Yeah, I really appreciate that perspective and that outlook and understanding the importance and the organizations that you've been involved with, them stressing the importance of making those connections. So it's just really great perspective. Sue, we are just about done, but before we conclude, we do have a tradition here on the podcast to close by asking our guest a pair of surprise questions. To keep things interesting, we have a list of 10 mystery questions to draw from. So please select two numbers between 1 and 10, and then I will ask you the corresponding questions. Okay. 2, if you were stranded on a deserted island, what one book, one album, and one movie would you take with you to keep yourself company? We will spot you a copy of the religious text of your choice. So other than that, what are your 3 entertainment survival kit picks? And again, it's one book, one album, one movie.
Album, it would have to be anything Bruce Springsteen. I'm a Jersey girl.
The Boss.
Books, I don't. Yeah. Books, I don't really read that much.
That's okay. Dang, you can skip it if you want.
I would take a beer with me if I could instead.
That's fine. Take a 6-pack.
Yes, that was even better. And the third one is take
a movie.
A movie. Favorite movies are the How to Train a Dragon movies, and now even more poignant because Hiccup is an amputee, and I'm going to actually take a picture of both of them and put them on my bike, which is now black. I finally learned how to ride an upright one and bought my own bike versus the loaner, and so they're going to be on my bike as inspiration to how to overcome. They had to overcome and learn how to fly again, and I'm overcoming it too.
Sounds like a great message. And then you also selected number 10. And number 10 is, what is your happy place and why?
Outside. Anything outside, whether it's just walking or running or biking or hanging out in the river and just looking at the water with the dog and throwing the ball for him. I love being outside.
Awesome. Well, being out in the sun does a body good, that's for sure. And improves the mindset as well. Well, Sue, I want to thank you again for spending a little bit of your day with us and for sharing your story. We always appreciate hearing the stories of the people who agreed to come on and spend some time with us. And so thank you for that.
Hopefully it can help somebody else.
Absolutely. I'm sure it will. And so with that, that brings us to the close of another episode of the Virginia Hospital and Healthcare Association's Patients Come First podcast. If you like what you heard, please make sure to leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcast and subscribe so that you know when new episodes are available. And once again, we want to thank our guest, Sue Henneberry, for joining us today. So thank you.
Thank you very much for having me.